So we'll get started. Welcome everyone to this live speaker series. This is our fourth speaker series. No, I'm sorry. It's our fourth external speaker. It's our fifth speaker that has been part of the Q1 All Remote Communication speaker series. The learning and development team has been putting on this speaker series for the whole quarter, bringing internal and external speakers to come and speak about different all remote communication strategies. And it's been really fun to have a lot of different guests come and share their expertise. And I'm really looking forward to having Joana here as our expert today. If you've never been to one of these sessions before, the way that they work, I'll add the meeting agenda to the chat if you don't have it up. But I give a little 2-minute intro, right, like I'm doing right now, as people trickle in. And then in a minute or so, I'll pass it over to Joana to introduce herself. After that, for about the first 20, 25 minutes or so, I have 3 questions that I will ask Joana in like an interview sort of format. And then at the end of those 3 questions, we will pass it off to an AMA style for Joana from any team members on the call. So as she and I are chatting, if you have any questions about things that are coming up or you have, you know, other questions that you want to ask Joana about, you can feel free to add those to the team member questions section of the agenda. And then we'll just get through as many as we can and we'll end at 15 minutes past. It's a 45 minute session. I think that's all I have. Also, you know what, I'll call out too, up at the top of the agenda in the recording section, I included a link to the playlist on our GitLab Unfiltered YouTube channel where you can rewatch or watch for the first time any of the other sessions that have been part of this series. They're all recorded there and this one will be added there too after we're all done. I think that's all I have. So I, like I said, really excited to have Joana, Pais, Afonso here to chat with us about managing information overload. So I'm going to pass it over to Joana to introduce herself a bit before we get started.
Thank you so much, Samantha, and all the Learning Development Program team for the invitation. It's really an honor for me to be here with you, really. You know, GitLab is one of these companies we always follow to be an example of remote work and, you know, great workplace. So I'm really honored for this invitation. It's really, I'm really proud to be here and I hope to be helpful in helping you out also thinking on these difficult topics, right? Overload of information is a hard one. So I can tell you a little bit about myself. I currently work at Deloitte. I'm based in Portugal. I'm based normally in Lisbon, in the capital, but I'm from Porto, the north of the country where I'm today because I'm visiting family while working remotely this week. I lived also some years in France and in Brazil, and my first souvenir from remote work gets back to 2011. Where I went to São Paulo and I had to be alone by 4 months, like almost like a small entrepreneur, but not really an entrepreneur, but working remotely from my room there. So it was quite demanding at the time. It was a sales role because my first initial background is marketing and sales for several years. And then I also start working, let's say, in my country remotely from home one day per week in 2014. So that's how I started, let's say, working outside of an office. And then in the last 3 to 4 years, I did a career change from marketing and sales in the tourism industry to employer branding and culture topics in consulting and technology companies. So I think that's a little bit my presentation.
Nice, yeah. Thanks, Joana. That was great. So I think I just want to make sure my internet isn't lagging. Okay, I think the connection's getting a little bit better. Can everyone hear me okay?
I'm hearing you very well.
You are? Okay.
Did you hear me well?
I did. Yeah. Yeah. There's just a little lag in the video. So I was trying to determine if it was my internet or not, but I think we're good. Okay, great. Thanks, Joana. So, and thanks everyone in the chat for confirming. I'm going to go on to our first question. So I think that managing a lot of information in an all remote environment is like one of the hardest things to do. And managing information like just in our lives, there's like media incoming messages is just coming at us all the time. So I think that this, I'm excited to talk about this question. So the question is, regardless of tenure at GitLab, many team members experience information overload in some shape or form. I'd love to start our conversation with a question about how team members can find balance with getting the right information and avoiding feeling overwhelmed with new information.
Thank you, Samantha. That's a very interesting and difficult question to address. I think there are some, you know, main ideas that we can share here during our conversation, but of course it will always be a, like a tailor-made plan for each one of us. I try to think more in a business perspective, in a more like, let's say, a professional way, more than just, you know, our full life and all the content that, you know, we manage in our personal lives too. One of the first topics I would like to highlight is our, if we are conscious of the priorities for us in terms of our jobs and our goals, priorities versus time management. Okay, so first of all, we need to make, of course, time and space for us to pay attention and to address what is relevant, what is critical to our goals in our work. And for that, we need to be available and open to read and to digest some relevant information. And we won't be able to skip it too much. What we can do is maybe try to balance and define what are the best slots and the best, you know, time for us to read the news and the new emails, the new message, you know, the new topics, because each one of us has different work styles, right? For example, some of us like to have focused deep dive work in the mornings, for example, and then in the afternoon more likely to get distracted or to talk with peers. And if that's the case, we should prioritize to do that focused work in the morning and maybe catch up on the rest of, let's say, the news in the afternoon, where our mind gets distracted and we end up being a little bit more multitasker. It can be completely the opposite. You can start in the morning just updating yourself on what is, you know, what are the most relevant topics, and then you start your focused deep dive work when you know you already have all the information, you're updated, you're not missing anything from last 12 hours, for example, so you can do a better job. So it really depends on the company, on your role also, so you can define your best model. Another thing is to set a little bit the rules of what to do with non-essential information, the rules for yourself. So it's really important for us to have some virtual conversations, coffee meetings, nice to know, nice to have information, company announcements that are relevant, checking on social media and so on. But maybe we can have these channels or this source of information more muted or without notifications, or, you know, trying to save some time for us to be concentrated in what is really important, and then allocate some time. It can be at the end of the day, it can be at the end of the week, let's say, to start checking some of the conversations that were less relevant, but still we want to know a little bit what happened, and, you know, and have an idea, not to be completely lost or outdated, let's say. So it's really a matter of first managing what is important and urgent and try to delegate what it's not read first emails of subject that we know we are just in copy, and it's good to know, but it's nothing we can do at the moment. Another tip that I think sometimes can be useful is another one. Do you remember sometimes when we are sick and we miss work for one day, for example, just one day or two, not much more than that sometimes? What happens to one email, one message that we couldn't answer is that someone else will answer. And then maybe that request was not the full complete request anymore. Maybe they even changed direction. And what we did was, by being sick, we miss having to send and read a lot of emails that maybe were not so useful. So one of the tips we could think is that maybe we should think on not answering immediately in the very first second if we could, because sometimes people, they just, you know, are not so complete in their briefings of the message, or they change their mind. So I'm not saying we skip our priorities or we do not answer colleagues. It's not about that, but it's just better that we don't feel anxious and we don't feel, you know, really concerned about, you know, 1-2 minute delay, 1 hour delay, depending on the priorities. Of course, again, getting back to the first point, what are the priorities, where I'm really, you know, helpful to take decision. So try it sometimes also to, if there's not a huge deadline, if you're not the first stakeholder, first to, you know, wait some minutes before, just go there and answer, react, and, you know, comment on that topic. Another thing that I'd like to share with you is that the feelings we have about this overload of information, it's really personal, and it can change depending on the, you know, the season, the days, what is happening in our personal and professional life. So the most important is that you feel, you know, confident and comfortable. So I suggest that you kind of monitor your feelings. And if you feel like this is really becoming overwhelming, you take an action plan. And that action plan can have, you know, different ways, like first talking with your manager or even your team members who are maybe constantly typing and sending to message. I don't know, maybe not. But if that happens, it's better to have an honest conversation about what could be the ideal team scenario for us to exchange on the daily updates, on the relevant improvements. It's really helpful to have this honesty and transparency to share what is the ideal scenario for this team communication. Also, this conversation can happen with your manager too, of course, or even ask opinion to a buddy in case you have a person in the organization, or a mentor, or even a friend. So the thing is that you feel well at the end of the day. There are also some resources for you to disconnect a little bit at the end of the day, and to change from your professional life to your personal and feel more relieved, you know, and leave your work at some point in the computer, but not in your mind all the time. And I'm pretty sure that you maybe already know some of these tools, like, you know, having some apps for mindfulness moments, or just having a relaxation moment, going for a walk. Samantha, she was saying, going for a walk at lunchtime, you know, having some sun, look at the ocean. We talked about that in the beginning. These are some of the small tips that can help us so much to manage and to cope with this information overload, as well as doing sports and, you know, other activities that bring you pleasure. And disconnect really from the source of information that brings you stress. So it can be social media, it can be, you know, work channels. So these are some of the ideas that I've thought. Mm-hmm. I don't know if there are other comments or questions.
No, I love this. This is like so many great ideas. And to me, it sounds like it really like comes down to building systems that help you manage the information, and having those systems be based on your work preferences, which I think is something that is really cool about GitLab, and being able to do that and being able to adjust your adjust how you work based on how you want to work. And I also recognize that like that might not feel like totally true for everybody at all times. But I think that, yeah, the focus on like building systems that work for you, systems are reliable. So you can kind of take the decision-making out of it on a daily basis and rely on those systems. Thank you so much. So this second question is a bit more specific, and I'd like to talk about like, especially because GitLab is growing, we have a lot of new team members. I'd love to ask you, what are some of the biggest challenges that are specific to new or onboarding team members in an all remote workspace as it relates to like, oh my gosh, I just joined this new company and there's 1 million things going on. And at GitLab, I can contribute to anything. And so how do I manage that as a new team member?
Okay, as a new team member, first of all, I would like to think that we all have first a personal responsibility in this onboarding too. So I think it comes from two ways, the way the company do the onboarding, and then we can talk about just afterwards, but also our approach to our onboarding. So first of all is thinking on, okay, what in my mind could be a kind of ideal onboarding plan, what I would expect to, you know, have some thought about that even before we start, what I like to know, who I like to meet in theory, which stakeholders could be relevant for myself, and then, you know, take note of all of this. So when we start the onboarding process, we can make sure if the company has already organized it, or if I, you know, need to be proactive and ask for the elements that I think that will be bring, you know, help me to have success on my new role. Another thing that happens is sometimes the onboarding plan, whatever it is, no matter how it's defined, can feel being too slow or too fast for my pace and what I was expecting. So some adjustments may be needed. And of course, the team leader should be paying attention and being very sensitive to that and try to adapt a little bit how the person is really, understanding the information and feeling clear in his mind. Also, there will always be gray zones. Like I know when I enter a new company, there will be always subjects that I didn't understand, I didn't heard about it, and I want to do questions, right? We are all curious to know a lot of things. So either this information is easily approachable and accessible, of course, in company handbooks and so on, but it's important for me to understand when can I ask what to who. And is with my team leader in the first week, maybe it's end of the day that I can have a 15-minute conversation about the gray zones I didn't understand from that day. Maybe it's an onboarding buddy that was allocated, you know, for myself, and I can ask him in a more, him or her, in a more informal way. Also, what is strange sometimes when we onboard, even not remote, is the business jargon, the business expressions that only happen in that company, that sometimes they seem to have a small different meaning than what we expected, right? Some shortcuts and, you know, some words that have some second meaning in this company, in this culture. And it's very important that we try to understand, to feel comfortable. What does it mean when someone says this in this company? Because I feel like there's some, you know, some body behavior, sometimes it's different from what I was expected. So as soon as someone can explain, or if you can read a little bit about this, you know, cultural codes and the way we address topics, it's very important, and it helps inclusion at the very beginning. First, also, one of the first things onboarding members want is connection and sense of belonging very, very quickly. So the better we can, and the sooner we can make this feeling happening through different ways, the better. and we can talk about, but it will be mostly about, you know, message of welcoming, could be videos, it could be even, you know, meeting, let's say outside in case we are in the same location and do some other non-work related activities together, either during the week or the weekend. So there are a lot of ways of tackling this, but it's definitely one of the hardest is to feel already the connection and the belonging in the remote situation when you are entering a new company. But for that, we can also have a peer that can help us and, you know, just, you know, address some of these subjects. And, you know, I've been in your place. I know what is not to know a lot of things and not have, you know, this this feeling of already being part of the company. So sometimes it's easier than just having the team leader.
Yeah. This is great too. And hearing you talk about it, I'm just thinking like, I think that some of these ideas about, you know, like learning the jargon or the how teams work with each other culturally. I think that even if you're not a new team member, like we work so functionally at GitLab that I think that all of this exists. Like if I were to show up in a meeting myself with like the finance team, I would feel like an onboarding team member on finance. And so I feel like this is all really important to remember even for people who have been at GitLab for a while, who are working with new team members or working with new teams when there are those gray zones. And I was also thinking too, we have this sub value within our credit values at GitLab, and it says something like, it's impossible to know everything. And I think that that's just like a really good reminder, because sometimes it can feel like you need to know everything, and just remembering that you actually can't, and that's okay. None of us can. So great.
Takes the pressure.
Yeah.
And it makes us all at the same level. Mm-hmm. And it strengthens our relationship. We are closer together on that.
Yeah, right. That's awesome. Okay, well, we have one more question before we go to the team member questions. And so this one is similar to what we kind of just talked about how, you know, as an individual, you can manage this kind of like information overload. I'd love to talk a bit about how managers and leaders, but also just like other team members as, you know, just like as leaders, as managers of one at GitLab, how do these people, how do we improve efficiencies and communication that support each other?
Yes, thank you so much, Amanda. There are some best practices, probably already have some of them, so I apologize if in any case this is already your situation. That would be a great sign also, so it will be good news. First of all is to try to customize an onboarding plan for the team member. I know it's quite natural that we think about an onboarding plan, you know, just let's say pretty similar for the first steps at least, but the more the employee feels like it's customized to his needs and to the team needs, the more it's effective and efficient, and it will generate that belonging sense that I told you about earlier. So if the manager can adapt that onboarding plan in a more customized way, and maybe we can also check in with the new team member, remembering the expectations that he had earlier before getting to the company, the stakeholders you'd like to meet, you know, all these questions and adapt this in the next 2 to 3 to 4 weeks. Also, another thing is in a daily basis, have a feedback from how is going on this onboarding, and can adapt and adjust very quickly in case something is going wrong or not in the right direction from both sides, let's say. So it's important to check in quickly on a daily basis, but also then have a more standard onboarding survey that can be done after the first week or after the first month to feel a little bit the overall feeling of this experience and how it can be improved for the next colleagues who will join the company. Another important tip that I think you have is having a great written culture and having this written communication document, like the company handbook, the culture book, the values, you know, all the way teams should be working together. But then more specifically in your closer team, it will be helpful to have this conversation that we talked earlier about our preference of work, our strengths, what we are very good at, what we love to do. So we know that for that topic, I can rely on my team member A or B, and I can ask help and support to team member C or D, because I already know they are very good on this topic or they love that one. So it reinforced the feeling of belonging in the shorter team and also our confidence in doing our work well. Also, we could define when onboarding a new team member, what is the preferred working schedule, meaning like the most important hours of this connection. Is it lunchtime? Is it later at night, early in the morning? Which time schedule it is? Time difference between colleagues and the way we should update ourselves. Is it a weekly team meeting? Is it another way? So if the person who comes feel like there he is heard, then you know it's being adapted also to his voice, let's say, and his preference, it will be an onboarding more successful. And then of course we need to know the team, we need to have those video message from the team or from the team member who is coming to the company to tell more about ourselves and also outside work. Who are we? Who are our authentic selves at work also? What do we love? What do we prefer not to know, not to do? This is sometimes our funny questions, funny topics that people can memorize very quickly. And they bring this feeling of, you know, getting to know each other and so on. So I think this is one of the most important things. Another one to finalize is in case the onboarding takes a little bit too long before the job letter, the job offer that I signed and accepted and the day. Of course, we need also to take care of a keep warm plan and having maybe those team members invited for an event that could be happening that is not too confidential. Maybe they can be the first to know a public information that will be available soon, but they feel already they are part of the team and then they're knowing in advance relevant information from product releases, for example, and so on.
Yeah, this is great. Thank you so much for sharing these. It's like a good reminder that both like building trust and then documenting kind of what comes out of that trust can establish our teams to really communicate better and integrate new team members, you know, regardless of if we are managers or not. Like, I think that we all have a responsibility to make people feel welcome and support them as we can. So thank you so much for that. Okay, so we have just about 15 minutes left and we're going to transition over to the team member questions. So if you have any questions for Joana, you can add them to the document and we'll go through as many as we can. There's one in there right now from Giacomo, and I'm wondering if Giacomo is still on the call and wants to voice the question.
Indeed, I'm here. I'll read it out from the document. Okay, so the question is that whether we knew or not, there's a number of channels, you know, that from Slack, emails, internal Confluence sites, you know. And as you said, obviously we can't know everything. How do we decide which channels we should really follow? Because those are, you know, we cannot do our work if we don't read the information there versus others that we could simply discard. Because the point is that we don't know because we're new. And so we can't really make that decision. So we keep, you know, we keep running after information, feeling that we're missing out. And it's not just the missing out as, you know, it's really like I'm unable to do my work unless I know that piece of information. You know, how do you reconcile the need of having to know things with you can't know everything? And this stresses me personally. That's why I'm asking.
Of course. Thank you so much, Giacomo, for your question. I think this should really be addressed. This question is very important in the onboarding stage and when, you know, articulating the people team with the team leaders, you know, corporate support, and to have it clear on the channels that you need. I think definitely you shouldn't be, you know, proactively asking too much. This information could be received more naturally, and maybe just need to be aligned between the teams so it can help everyone to stick to the priority ones where we'll make sure that everything that is important is there. However, and because the world is not perfect, my personal feeling on this, I always tend to prefer to have more information than missing information. So it's easier for me to feel overwhelmed by information because I end up choosing having more subscriptions and more, you know, chats open, and then just choose where I go and when. And of course it can be tiring and a little bit overwhelming, but maybe in the first stage it's better to be open to know a little bit more and do more an effort of attention at the beginning so we can understand better the bigger picture. Because sometimes, of course, we have a job to do and we need to be very specific, but if we don't understand the bigger picture and how the other stakeholders and colleagues, you know, are working along with our team, we miss part of the relevancy of the answer we can bring, right? So it's always a balance between what is obvious for our job role and that we need to ask our team leader and our team members, the closest one, to tell us from their experience what are, you know, this can be like 2-3 questions that we can even ask to several peers, for example. If the company officially cannot tell us easily, we can address those questions to 3 or 4 team members and check if they do say the same, if there is any gap of expectation between them, so we can decide our own choice. And then honestly talking with the manager, saying, okay, that was my thoughts and perspectives based on what I know, that I'm, you know, relying on this source of information. Do you feel I'm missing something? Do you feel I should be, you know, being informed in other circles of information, and then probably we'll get to the ideal world where we know the minimum and the best, but we are not overloaded with information that we don't need.
Okay, thank you.
I hope that helps.
Yeah, if there isn't another question, I may make a comment. I don't want to take time from others.
Go for it.
Yeah, so the comment is that I think we're better off if we know more than if we know less. But unless our job is to collect and aggregate information, you know, we can't be doing that the whole day. And I think the more channels we have available to us, I think the more we run the risk of producing a lot of noise. And I don't want this to sound negative, but, you know, there's so much information that you really don't know. Like, you may be reading a channel and it's interesting, but maybe interesting isn't needed. It's just interesting. And you shouldn't be, you know, on the interesting channel. You should be on the stuff that you really need. And,
exactly.
You know, and yeah.
That's a little bit what I said in the first question about the very first thing we need to do is to understand what is important and relevant for our job. And then what is nice to know, interesting, as you said, and start from there very quickly, because without that visibility, we are not self-confident to do all the rest, and we will lose some time. So I think that's the very first honest conversation, one of the first we should have. What is relevant for myself also in terms of the first months of onboarding, for example? What are your expectations in terms of, you know, work and achievements? What are the channels and the people I should be meeting with? And then all the rest is, as you said, interesting. So you can define like, okay, I have half an hour per day or per week to just have a look to the interesting topics and not be totally out of the information, but it's not my priority in a daily basis.
Yeah, thank you. Like, I know there is no, you know, there's no answer which works for everybody. It's just bring it up as a point.
There's not a magical answer.
Yeah. I'm going back to read my Slack channels. Thank you.
Thank you, John.
I think that the like suggestion, because I like I try personally to like block off time during the day dedicated to checking Slack, but I just think of it as like, okay, gonna check Slack, like all of Slack. But I think that what you're saying, Joana, that I think is like new for me is it's not just time to catch up on those messages, but you have to be more intentional of like, this is the time I'm gonna spend catching up on essential things. And this is a separate time that I'm going to spend catching up on interesting things.
And these interesting things sometimes are for learning. For example, I subscribe a lot of newsletters of my thought leadership topics that I work and that I love. So it's a mix of work and passion. So sometimes even on the weekends, I feel like I will read a little bit those newsletters. So I spend 1 week accumulating those newsletters that I don't read. Then I look to the subject and I feel like this one, if I have to choose, is my first one. I won't read half of them. I don't really have time. But from the subject, I can already choose my top three, and then I have a dedicated time per week to read that, and I will be learning, and maybe then I can have an action plan to share that with my colleagues too, or to schedule to share on social media during the week. So it's a matter of really having intention, as you said, Samantha, of, okay, this is my work and this is what is relevant. And then I have some time during the week for nice to have and choose wisely what are the priorities for myself, or because I need it, or because they are passions. And I feel motivated and energized by that.
Yeah, that's great. Thanks so much, Joana. We have a few more minutes left and there's no more questions in the doc, but I just wanted to open it up for a minute to see if there are any other questions that someone wants to verbalize. Cool. Well, we can wrap things up a bit early then. Joana, thank you so much for joining us for this conversation. It was really interesting. I feel like you challenged me to think a little bit differently than the way I currently read and process information at GitLab, and I hope that you did the same for others. And I appreciate all of you for being on the call and taking some time out today to learn about all remote communication.
Thank you so much, Samantha, and all the team for being there and for the opportunity. Thank you so much. Have a great day.
You too. Thanks, everyone. Bye.